Welcome to my channel Lenovate. In this video, we will going to discuss the chapter from the physiology that is about the local and the humoral control of the tissue blood flow. As we all know that the tissue blood flow is very important for the certain needs of a tissue. The entire body that is formed from the organ system having the different tissues. So these tissue require the adequate amount of oxygen, adequate amount of hydrogen, adequate amount of nutrients, and also there is a need for the removal of the carbon dioxide. So according to tissue need, there must be a adequate tissue blood flow to complete their tissue need. So we will going to discuss in this video that how the tissue blood flow, that is the local and the humoral control, is controlled in the body. Well, that is for nervous regulation of the blood pressure, blood flow, we have discussed in a separate video. So the local, that is particularly to the specific area of the body where the tissue needs the blood flow, and the humoral control includes the hormones that include the nitric oxide, endothelials, and certain type of different hormonal effects that control the blood tissue flow. Now we are going to start from the local tissue blood flow. In this, we are going to discuss about the oxygen demand theory and the vasodilator theory. The first diagram we have is the oxygen demand theory. The oxygen demand theory explains the amount of oxygen that is needed by our tissue. So the tissue need having an oxygen demand. In this diagram, you can see that there is a mechanism that is shown that when there is a decrease in the oxygen delivery to the tissue, or when there is an increased metabolism of a tissue, that's why the need of the tissue towards the oxygen and the blood flow increases. If the tissue metabolism is increased, or if there is hypoxic condition. So what happens, there will be a decrease in the tissue oxygen because the metabolicity of the tissue is increased. That's why tissue need more oxygen, and the decreased tissue oxygen will going to start a mechanism, and this is actually the vasodilator theory, or also called as the oxygen demand theory, in which there will be relaxation of arterioles and the pre-capillary sphincters, and there will be relaxation, there may increase blood flow to the tissue, and that's why when the tissue blood flow will going to increase, it will causing the negative feedback to a decreased tissue oxygen, and ultimately there will be an increased tissue oxygen, that is the delivery of oxygen will going to increase to that particular tissue that need a more oxygen or nutrients. So we are going to discuss it by diagram. Here you can see, this is shown a picture of a vessel in which this is connected the arteries with the metarterioles, and these metarterioles are connected by a smooth muscle fibers. Here at the level of every metarterial, well, there is a sideway capillaries attached. There is a presence of a sphincter that is called as a pre-capillary sphincter. And this sphincter is almost completely closed, or it may be completely open. It is no between the partially open or partially closed. It is always completely closed or completely open. So what happens when the tissue need is going to increase? These are the tissue cells. If there is a metabolism increase or there is a hypoxic condition, they need more blood flow. So what happens? This sphincter will going to constrict. This sphincter will going to constrict or dilate according to the tissue need. But here, if there is a hypoxic condition or decreased oxygen delivery to the tissue, these sphincters will going to dilate. When the sphincter dilate or open, there will be a more blood flow through the sideway capillaries and ultimately to the tissue cells that are present sideway to the capillaries. And in this way, the blood flow to the tissue is increases, and from the blood flow, the tissue can easily get the nutrients and the oxygen. Because of the vasodilation of the blood vessels, because of the opening of pre-capillary sphincter. So this is a simple mechanism of the oxygen demand theory. That's why it's also called as the vasodilator theory. Now coming to the another mechanism, that is the acute tissue control. That is the acute local blood flow control through the two pathways. The acute tissue blood flow control is either metabolic or it is either myogenic. Because the metabolism of tissue increase, when the metabolism of tissue increase, it will need more and more oxygen, and there is a requirement of the nutrients are also increased. So there are two conditions that occur. Hyperemia is a condition in which there is a increase activity or increased amount of the blood flow to the tissue. So there are two conditions that we call as the reactive hyperemia and the active hyperemia. The reactive and the active hyperemia are considered in this graph, showing the diagram here, the first graph is showing the reactive hyperemia. In the reactive hyperemia, what happens when there is a decreased tissue blood flow or there is a complete blockage of tissue blood flow for a shorter period of time to a particular tissue? Example, when there is a myocardial infarction or there is an atrial fibrillation, there will be a decrease or a complete blockage of a blood flow to a particular heart muscle tissue. So when there is a decreased blood flow or complete artery occlusion for a certain period of time, and then the tissue blood flow is going to increase, or the you can say the artery is going to open, there will be a peak in the graph, that is the increase in the blood flow ultimately towards the tissue. That is called as the reactive hyperemia, that is the reaction of the artery occlusion to the tissue. That's why there will be a peak, and simultaneously there will be a rushing of the blood flow through the vessel. So this is called as the reactive hyperemia, and the increase in the blood flow will going to ultimately will going to normalize in certain time, in certain period of time. So here it is the muscle blood flow that is increased. The second condition we call is as the active hyperemia. In the active hyperemia, what happens when there is a decreased blood flow? But here the condition is different from the decreased blood flow. Here what happens is that tissue metabolism is increased. When the tissue metabolism is increased in any of the condition, in example, we can say the exercise or that condition is causing the increased tissue metabolism. So the tissue metabolism increase, the need of oxygen and need of nutrients also increase. So in that part, when the body and the muscle is active, there will be an increase in the blood flow and there will be a peak in the graph that is called as the active hyperemia. And there is an active muscle contraction and active tissue blood flow, that's why called as the active hyperemia, and then the peak will be down and the homeostasis will be maintained throughout the time. But here in this condition, the condition was related with the tissue metabolism. But in the other graph that we have seen in the reactive hyperemia, the tissue was most the condition was related with the tissue hypoxia, that is a decreased oxygen artery occlusion. So there are two different cases that we call as the metabolic theories of the acute local blood flow control. Now we're going to discuss about the myogenic theory. In the myogenic theory, what happens is the autoregulation of blood flow. When there is a more and more blood flow, there will be a release of vasodilators and there will be a vasodilation of a vessel. And when there is a increased blood flow, over increased blood flow, what happens that the vasodilators will be washed away, and when these vasodilators will be washed away, there will be a vasoconstriction of the blood vessel. And these conditions occur in any injury or any about when there is an increased blood pressure to prevent the further increase. That's why there will be a vasoconstriction of the vessel. So that is the other control that we call as the myogenic control of the blood flow. That is the local blood flow is controlled by myogenic. These two mechanisms, including the metabolic and the myogenic control, are called as the autoregulation of the blood flow, local blood flow control. Now the third we can discuss here is the humoral control through the nitric oxide mechanism. So coming to the third diagram, here you can see this is shown a vessel that having a stress on it. This is a stimulus for a stress condition. So what happens when there is a stress or decreased blood flow in the body tissue, or there will be a hypoxic condition, there will be a release of the nitric oxide. The nitric oxide, as we all know, is a major vasodilator substance. And what happens, how it releases? It releases from the reaction between the oxygen and arginine, that's an amino acid, in the presence of enzyme, there is epithelial nitric oxide synthase, and this enzyme will going to convert the nitric oxide plus formation of this citrulline will be formed. And this nitric oxide, there is a vasodilator, will going to activate the pathway that is the guanosyl acetylcyclase pathway, and the GTP, that is a guanosyl triphosphate, will going to convert into the guanosyl monophosphate, and there will be a release for the relaxation of muscle. There will be a vasodilators, release of vasodilators through the mechanism, and there will be ultimately the relaxation of the smooth muscle, also the relaxation of the blood vessel, because the smooth muscles are attached on the arterioles. So there will be a relaxation of arterioles ultimately, and there will be a increase in the blood flow to the tissue. So this is an also another mechanism for the acute tissue blood control. Now if we discuss in long-term control of the blood flow, what happens in the long-term regulation? In the long-term regulation, the condition is different from the acute, because in the long-term regulation, the vascularity of the tissue will increase. There will be increase and increased formation of the blood vessel, increased vascularity of the tissue, and that condition is called as the angiogenesis. That is the formation of new blood vessels that occur, and that that remain for longer period of time. That's why this is a long term control. And in this graph, we can compare the mechanism of the acute tissue blood control and the long term tissue blood control. That is, the acute blood control is highest, but it remains not for a longer period of time. It's peak and then it will going to down regulate, while the long term mechanism will going to up regulate and it will control under the longer period of time for the tissue blood flow and maintain the arterial pressure. So this was all about the conditions, the regulation of the humoral and the arterial acute and the humoral control of the blood tissue blood flow. I hope you'll be explained well. Thank you for watching. Subscribe for more and don't forget to give feedback on our Facebook page.